standing in the sun. I can only imagine when our life.
One, good morning. Welcome to White Bluff Chapel. It's so good to see everybody this morning. We've been looking forward to this Sunday for months, and it has arrived. Today is Covenant Sunday, the day we've been preparing our hearts for and praying for. Before we start our service, I do have a few announcements. They are in the back of the bulletin if you'd like to follow along. First of all, there'll be a congregational meeting next Sunday, April the 28th. At 11:45 in the Fellowship Hall. On Mother's Day, we will have a special baby dedication during our morning services for any family with a newborn or a toddler. This could be your child or a grandbaby. Please contact the chapel office by May 6th if you would like to have your child participate in this service or if you have any questions. May 4th at 8 o'clock, there will be a men's breakfast provided by the men's ministry. Be prepared for some fun, fellowship, a guest speaker, and some exciting news. So men, how can you resist that? On May 5th, the youth will have a pizza and pickleball party. It's 6 p.m. at the pickleball courts. June 17th through the 20th, Vacation Bible School. You know that date's going to come up fast. This year's theme is scuba, diving into a friendship with God. And finally, June 30th through July 4th, Wild Week at Carolina Creek Youth Camp. So if you'd please join me in prayer as we prepare our hearts for worship. Dear Father, thank you for this special Sunday. We've been praying to you for months, praying that you will open our hearts to help us to know how we can help in this building expansion campaign, praying for guidance in knowing what you are calling each of us to do. Please continue to lead us today. Amen.
Well, good morning and welcome. And we are indeed here this morning to behold our God, to worship and praise his name. If you would, let's all stand and join our voices together and do that very thing. Our first hymn this morning is, "To God Be the Glory, Great Things He Has Done." Scripture reading.
Stand for the word of God. Seek while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways, and the outrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them, and our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. This is the word of God.
Amen. Thank you, Grayson, for leading us this morning. You may be seated as we continue to sing this morning, to worship. The next song we'll sing together is Waymaker.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper.
If you would stand and sing with us this next song this morning, How Great Is Our God.
Great is our God. Sing.
Good morning. Please join me in prayer. Oh, gracious Heavenly Father, today we celebrate Covenant Sunday. We have joyfully spent months praying for your direction for Wycliffe Chapel. We have heard your vision, and we have established your vision as our mission. Father, we dedicated this chapel to your glory 20 years ago, and today we pursue your vision to expand the chapel for the next 20 years. To better serve our community, the neighboring communities, and all the people we touch in our mission outreach programs. Father, to everyone involved in the creation of Wycliffe Chapel, we owe a deep sense of gratitude and appreciation. This chapel is yours, and we are so blessed to be able to come to you today and worship you. To the Chapel Board of Trustees, to the Needs Assessment Committee, to the Fundraising Committee, we thank you for your leadership and guidance needed to move forward to bring God's vision to reality. For all those individuals involved, we give your thanks. Now it's time to involve the entire congregation, the entire Wycliffe community, all the friends and followers of Wycliffe Chapel, as we all join together to make God's vision our mission. Father, you have been so generous with your blessings to all of us, and now it is time to return to you a portion of those boundless generosity. Father, fill our hearts with joy as we make our individual financial commitments to you this day. Father, we ask continued blessings to the members of the church family suffering from health issues, from life challenges, loss of family members, and loss of loved ones. We continue to mourn the passing of Susie, but celebrate the joy she has in your presence. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you today. We thank you for the freedoms we have, and we thank you for the greatest gift of all, your gift of salvation and eternal peace. All these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you, George. You may have heard the expression, someone is sitting in the shade today because someone planted a tree a long time ago. That saying is very pertinent today. It's a reminder that our actions, even very simple actions, can make a big difference. Now, symbolically, there have been many people in our lives that have planted trees. It could be parents and grandparents, for those loved ones, for friends. There are those that plant trees for us and plant trees of influence that we don't even know. That politician, the statesman that stood very strongly. It could be the soldier or airman, marine or sailor who fought for our freedoms. It could be the church and the leaders who have stayed the course of preaching and teaching of Christ, men and women who have interceded for us in prayer in times when we didn't even know that they were praying for us, that they were giving that time to be able to pray for us. During the past several months, we've had the opportunity to take a look back at the Wycliffe Chapel, look at our history, to look at us today and who we are, and certainly to look ahead to the future. When we have reflected upon the memories of humble beginnings and providing a Bible study in homes, leading to a worship experience in borrowed space, and then looking at 20-plus years ago when this building was built. During that time, and including today, there were multiple decisions that had to be considered, decisions that were prayed over and discussed and finally implemented. There's a legacy of faith for those who provided a shade trees for us. So it's humbling that we can stop and we can think about those that gave those shade trees and that provided those, but also the fact that today we have the opportunity to plant those seeds of faith as well. Seeds that will grow, will will germinate and we'll be able to see the product of that in 5, 10, 20, 30 years down the road. Today we come to our Covenant Sunday, and after much prayer and deliberation, not only in the past several months, but many of you know that the conversation of a new facility and an expansion of facility has been actually for several years. We focus today on that expansion. We've been praying during that time for the right time. And now we believe as a congregation that that time is now. It's time to not only talk about the need, but to financially support the idea, to bring it to its fruition. Before us is a call to build up among the shade trees that have been built for us, and to build upon the truth of the Word of God and His mission and His vision, so that we can reach our community for Christ in ways that God desires. Now, when we think about the Scripture, there are several biblical examples that we could look at of men and women who were willing to step out in faith, knowing that someone is sitting in the shade today because someone planted a tree a long time ago. So let me introduce to you one particular shade tree planter. His name is Jeremiah. Jeremiah was a prophet of Judah for some 40 years. Humanly speaking, if you were to look at his life and his ministry from our perspective and looking at the metrics and the graphics that we like to do sometimes, he wasn't much of a success. But he was a success in the eyes of God because of his faithfulness. So go back to about 587 BC and in Jeremiah 32, and I invite you to turn to that. Jeremiah 32, the prophet is in prison, not because of a crime that he had committed, but because the king didn't agree with the words of this prophet. So Jeremiah chapter 32, beginning in verse 1. This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. The army of the king of Babylon was then besieging Jerusalem. And Jeremiah the prophet was confined in the courtyard of the guard in the royal palace of Judah. Now, Zedekiah, king of Judah, had imprisoned him, saying, "Why do you prophesy as you do? You say, 'This is what the Lord says, I am going to give this city into the hands of the king of Babylon, and he will capture it.'" Let's stop there for a moment. We read it over in chapter 52 that King Zedekiah was 21 years old when he became king. In our passage here, we see that he had ruled for 10 years. He was going to rule for another year before he would be overthrown and the city would be destroyed. Jeremiah had been warning that because of the unfaithfulness of the people and its leaders, destruction was imminent. And Zedekiah, the king, in his youth perhaps, was not very happy with the words of Jeremiah. And he says, basically, "Why are you being such a negative Nelly here? Why can't you tell me something good? Why can't you tell me that everything's going to be fine?" But Jeremiah, being faithful to the Lord, said, actually, it will not be fine. In fact, the Babylonians are already besieging Jerusalem. Verse 5, we see that even if you push back, nothing will happen. You will be defeated. So in the midst of that, in verse 6, we see an interesting transaction that takes place. Verse 6, Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me, Hanamel, the son of Shalom, your uncle, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field at Anathoth, because as nearest relative, it is your right and duty to buy it.' Then, just as the Lord has said, my cousin Hanamel came to me in the courtyard of the garden and said, 'Buy my field at Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin, since it is your right to redeem it and possess it to buy for yourself.' I knew this is the word of the Lord. So I bought the field at Anathoth from my cousin Hanamel and weighed for him 17 shekels of silver. I signed and sealed the deed and had it witnessed and weighed out the silver on the scales." So again, imagine this. The city is under siege. It's about to fall. And there's a vision that Jeremiah has that the Lord provides, that this cousin will come and ask him to buy this field and to be able to purchase this particular piece of ground. Now, Anathoth was Jeremiah's hometown. It was a couple of miles north of Jerusalem. In fact, if they are besieging Jerusalem, the Babylonian army is probably on that very ground at this time. Jeremiah tells the king, "The Lord told me that my cousin would approach me to buy this property, and sure enough, here he is." Hanamel comes, and he wants to sell the property, probably because he realizes things are not good. And so he's like, "I'm out of here. Jeremiah, if you want it, I will sell it to you." At the end of the day, Jeremiah buys the property, signs the deed. Apparently, Jeremiah had never heard the three main considerations of real estate, of location, location, location. Verse 13, "In their presence I gave Baruch these instructions. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says: take these documents, both the sealed and the unsealed copies of the deed of purchase, and put them in a clay jar so that they will last a long time. For this is what the Lord Almighty, God of Israel, says: houses, fields, and vineyards will again be bought in this land." Several things we can look at this story. We do know that Babylonians indeed conquered the land. We do know that many of the survivors were taken away into a foreign land, and they were gone for some 70 years. More wars took place, and the Persian army came, and they defeated the Babylonians, and at that defeat, the Persians said, "You can go home." And so they did. So 70 years after Jeremiah bought the property, they returned home, and guess what was waiting for the descendants of Jeremiah? There was a piece of land where they built houses, and they built a life to begin again. High points of the story is Jeremiah heard from the Lord. Jeremiah was willing to obey. Jeremiah was committed, and Jeremiah had a godly vision. So how does that overlay into what we're looking at today on Covenant Sunday? I think those very points is that we are called to be willing to hear from the Lord. And we have attempted to do that in so many ways, again, the last several years, but especially the last few months, to say, "Lord, is this the direction you have for us? Should we build a building? Is this the right time? What is our motivation?" We've taken the time to look at the need and establish the need. We've taken time to ponder and to pray. And then we rinse and repeat and ponder and pray and ponder and pray. And we've had people speak, and we've had all these different motions in place. And we are saying, "Lord, is this truly your will? Lord, we desire to hear your direction." Not only to hear, we should be like Jeremiah and be willing to obey. To say, "Lord, if it's your will, and we believe it is, then I personally want to be obedient in following you." With that obedience come steps of commitment, tangible steps of commitment. We've been challenged to go beyond saying, "It sounds good, it's a great idea, why don't we do it?" to implementing and having that personal choice and personal commitment. Like Jeremiah, we should be willing to take the piece of paper and sign our name upon the paper and to say, "This is what I believe God has shown me to be able to give this to the glory of God." I like the story of the church in the Deep South where the preaching style was a talk-back kind of style, and the pastor was leading the people to commit. And so the preacher said the church should be like those who were healed by Jesus and told, "Get up and walk," and we should walk. And the congregation replied, "Let it walk, preacher, let it walk." The preacher said this church and the power of God should be like Elijah. It's got to run. And the congregation replied, "Let it run, preacher, let it run." The preacher said, "The church has got to mount up with wings like eagles, and it's got to fly." And the congregation in resounding voice said, "Let it fly, preacher, let it fly." And then the preacher, at the very moment of excitement, said, "If this church is going to fly, it's going to take money." There was a pause. The congregation replied with a lack of enthusiasm, "Let it walk, preacher, let it walk." You see that the story shows that our commitment is tied to our vision. What do we believe that God has for us to do? Like Jeremiah, we need to see the houses and the fields in the days to come, seeing beyond the land, beyond the structure, and to look to the people. It's not about a building. It's not about building a structure. It's about fulfilling the mission and the vision that God has for us, planting for the future, no matter what the future may even look like. The reformer Martin Luther said, "Even if I knew that tomorrow the world would go to pieces, I would plant my apple tree." It's the picture of a faith described in Hebrews 11. The faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The spirit of Elijah, that even when the world seems to be falling apart, "I will build that field. I will listen to what God has for me. I will commit to that, and through obedience, I will follow him." The White Bluff Chapel, we don't know what the future holds. We don't know what's around the corner in our society. We don't know what to expect. We just kind of live day to day and seek the Lord. But we do know this. We do know that our God is there, and that there is a vision and a mission that is before us as we are faithful in planting those seeds of faith. We can anticipate that vision 5, 10, 20 years from now, when there are men and women, boys and girls, students, senior adults, sitting, walking, and running in the presence of Jesus, because today, beginning today, those seeds of faith were planted. May we all come behind the one to find us faithful. And speaking of those words, there's a contemporary Christian artist, Steve Green, that has a song that is entitled, "To Find Us Faithful." Encourage you as we think about these words and in this day and our commitment to listen to the words that are said. And with that desire, Lord, today, find us faithful.
Journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us light the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through God. Oh, our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must follow.
Get into this. I have a couple of things to say. If you are a guest here worshiping with us today, you are exempt. Okay? And I want to be really clear. In every worship service, we have guests. People here for the first time, people here from out of town, people who are not a committed part of this fellowship. And so if you fall into that category, don't feel awkward, don't feel squirmy, don't leave, but don't think we're expecting a card from you, okay? Are we clear? Guests are exempt. All right, now the ushers are going to come and begin to distribute the commitment cards. If you were at a worship service last Sunday, you saw an example, and maybe you brought yours back filled out, and if that's the case, then you can use that one. But we're going to take a moment for all of us members to take a look at the commitment we're signing. Now, another little thing, small thing, is when it comes time to return these in just a minute, there's an envelope. Each card comes with an envelope. And I want to alert you, this is the kind of envelope that has a peel and stick flap on it. Okay, you see that? It peels. I'm telling you that because word has it that some of the smartest people among us were trying to lick these envelopes early. Peel and stick, it's the latest technology. While we take just a minute to get those distributed, I'm just going to let you know how it's go. In just a moment, we're going to have a moment for you to put your heads together as couples or whatever you need to do and actually write in the amount, the 3-year commitment that you intend to give, and then to print your name. If you can sign legibly, that's fine, but we're asking you to print your name so we can keep records more easily and also just so you'll understand, this is not a signed legal document that anybody's going to legally hold you to. But yeah, it's been said today beautifully that for months we've been thinking about this, we've been pondering and we've been praying. And I trust that a lot of you in the last couple of weeks have really seriously, as families, discussed your commitment, and you've talked about
you know, the need. You've talked about the excitement and how optimistic you are about our future, the leadership we have in place and all those things. Maybe you've scared yourselves a little bit. I know Dindi and I have when talking about what amount are we going to write on that card. It's good if you have, because what we're giving belongs to God and comes from God. It's not dependent upon what we have or what we can afford. It's what God wants to pour through you into the work of his kingdom. So if you would join me here, I want us to read together the top paragraph on the commitment card, just that top part, and we can all join our voices together. Believing that with God all things are possible, we have spent months pondering, praying, and seeking God's direction. We have seen God bring more people of all ages into this fellowship, and we believe God's will is for the expansion of White Bluff Chapel. In this moment, we open our hearts to God's leading and joyfully express our obedience to him. Father, we do pray once again as we come to this time of commitment that you would lead us. Give us courage, give us faith, help us trust and know that you, who are the giver of every good and perfect gift, just desire to give through us to the work of your kingdom. And so, Lord, guide us in this moment of commitment. Amen. Now take a moment to, if you need to talk with your spouse or whatever, let's fill in the cards, seal them into the envelopes, and then in just a moment, members of the committee, the God's Vision, Our Mission Committee, will be circulating among you to take up the cards. See, we have some committee members ready. So if you have your envelope sealed, just hold it up and someone will see you and will come to you and receive that from you. Did we miss anyone? In just a moment, Perry, who's been the chairman of our God's Vision, Our Mission campaign, is going to come and present those, your covenant cards on the altar of the Lord. Let's pray together one more time. Dear Father, we are so thankful to be a part of something great that you are doing. Lord, we're thankful that just a few years ago you brought leadership into our midst that had a vision and a desire to reach more broadly out into the community. And Lord, we're thankful that now as a congregation we have the opportunity to step out not to walk, not to run, but Lord, to see your kingdom fly in our midst. Give us faith, give us courage as we go forward in our mission. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Place those there, Perry. Thank you. Now Aaron's going to lead us as we worship the Lord.
Let's stand together, join our voices, and sing the first verse and chorus of Praise Him, Praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, oh, worth His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him, highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, ever in joyful song.
This morning we close our Covenant Sunday. Just a reminder that we come to worship week after week, and every Sunday is the day of celebration and a time of joy, and again, planting those seeds of faith and those shade trees that we never know where it's going to go. And praise the Lord that we can do that week after week. I would like to have just a special prayer over this this basket of commitment cards that were given, and a reminder for the dedication and the commitment and the vision that we have before us. Let's pray together. Our Father, we do thank You, Lord, for the ability to praise You, Lord, daily. Lord, the ability to come before You and know, Lord, that we have the opportunity to live in the light of Your grace and Your mercy. Father, we pray that we can be ambassadors to our community to spread the good news, that, to know truly that Jesus is Lord. Father, we thank You for the White Bluff Chapel, and we thank You, Lord, for the ways in which You've touched our hearts and lives over the years, and Lord, the impact and the influence that has been given. Father, we thank You for these cards of commitment, Lord, the sacrifice that is represented, in knowing, Lord, that we are dedicating this work to Your glory. And Father, we just pray, Lord, as we continue to grow in numbers and grow in faith and build disciples, Lord, that we can do so in Your glory. Lord, we pray, Lord, that we can continue to be the people of faith You called us to be. And Lord, help us always to have the attitude of prayer, or to pray as You have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. God bless each of us as we go and share the good news of Jesus Christ.